So we'll move on to our third subtopic, which is packages. Now in here, we'll understand the various kind of packages that is provided by the hotel. Say for example, a meal package, a holiday package, a meeting package or wedding package. Let's just understand how this happens at the hotel. Now at a glimpse, we'll understand what are the types of packages. Like I had mentioned, a meeting, a conference package. So the conference package will include rooms, a meeting room or a conference hall, food and beverage, definitely. Without food, how will the guest survive, right? So if, for example, a special equipment and audiovisual equipment, local activities like sightseeing and trips, special events for the group. Example, a musical show, just to break in the monotony. Then we can have a type 2 package, which is a marriage package. That would include a marriage venue. For example, certain activities can happen outdoors, certain can be indoors. So both outdoors and indoors. Then there's decoration, arrangements, lights, flowers, fooding, everything. Limousine or a luxury car for guests. Banquet hall and reception room for the parties to be attending. Rooms for guests. A special suite or a special room prepared for the newly wedded couple. Type 3 is a holiday package. So they'll definitely have prior information on travel arrangement, rooms, foods, activities, trips, special arrangements. For example, if somebody is spending their birthday or they're spending their anniversary, so it's the joint effort of the F&B, the front office and everybody. All the other interdepartments will try and make the visit of our guests very special and memorable. Then we have type 4, the meal package. That's very important. It's a combination of room and three types of meal. For example, breakfast, lunch and dinner. So it can be room and breakfast, can be room and breakfast, dinner or lunch, either of the two. Can be rooms, breakfast, lunch and dinner, all of the three. Okay. So the types of plans are European plan, continental plan, American plan, modified American plan, which is MAP, Bermuda plan. Okay. With that, we finish our third subtopic, which is meal packages. We'll move on to our fourth subtopic, which is going to be room tariff fixation. So the last exercise, we had stopped at company volume guaranteed rate. We'll continue with the same topic.
We come to our next topic, which is airline's crew rate. It's a special discounted rate offered to the employees of a recognized airline. So the discount can be, say, about 40 to 50% on the best available rate. And the booking is generally done online, okay? Discounts can also be on F&B services or spa services that the hotel may offer to the crew. A government rate is a rate or a service which is provided to government officials, okay, according to their rank. So a hotel can design rates in such a way that all the officers or services, all his needs are covered within their allowance remit. An educational rate is for, an educational rate is offered to, for example, students or teachers of an educational institute. The rates might not be very less, but since it's a part of a regular income, and the hotel doesn't want to lose on this revenue, so they prefer such rates. Membership rates are for loyal members, okay, which they frequently visit hotels for their benefits with cards and points, okay. Members of politically and socially powerful organizations. For example, members also of FHRAI, IATA, IATO, UNWTO, etc. They are also offered membership rates, special discounted rates. An introductory rate is offered to anyone when a hotel is newly opened. So when the hotel is pre-opening, okay, and there are already 2-3 hotels in the market, so it's a very small effort that the hotel makes from their end when they want their business to be to become flowy and to become strong, and when that happens, the rates will go up. A complimentary rate may be provided to ministers, IAS officers, IPS officers, special celebrities or relatives of the GM and GM to, okay, and but the permission should be coming from the GM of the hotel or the front office manager. They are the person eligible to take such decisions. Okay, and why is it so? That's basically to prevent misuse of any services. A crib rate, on the other hand, is a special rate for children or babies. Okay, so from 0 to 6, it's absolutely complimentary. That's for infant. From 6 to 12, it's charged half a price. And from 12 onwards, it's charged as an adult. The child, he's not a child anymore. He'll be treated as an adult. So in the next chapter, what we'll study would be the package rate, the various packages that the hotel offers, meeting, marriage, holiday or meal plans. Okay, so stay tuned. On the third unit, we'll be discussing on this. We'll continue with our fourth topic, which is room tariff fixation. Fixing of a tariff is a difficult task for the management. We do agree with the same line. However, if the rate is too high, guests may not patronize the property. Meaning, the guest might not feel like coming to the property paying for the same services if he finds that the other hotel is charging for the same services, the same facilities, but at a lower cost. He'll definitely choose the other hotel. Now, an accurate and a competitive room rate is one of the prerequisites for running a successful hospitality business. So for fixing tariff, there are two methods. One is a cost-based method and the other one is a market-based method. Now we learn room tariff fixation. One is cost-based, like I said, and the other one is market-based. So under cost-based, we have the rule of thumb approach. And the second one would be Herbert's formula. For market-based, we have as per competition, as per market tolerance, rate cutting, non-inclusive and inclusive rate. And the other one, the most important one would be the guest requirement, whatever the guest needs. So we'll take up the topic first, market-based pricing. For this, you need not go into details. Just understand one thing, that this is a common sense approach. Okay, management looks at a comparable hotels in the geographical market area, meaning side by side hotels, and sees what they are charging for the same product. Okay, the thought behind this is that the hotel can charge only what the market will accept, and this is usually dictated by a competition based method. Now, there can be many problems with this approach, although it's not very used, as in often used. First, if the property is new, construction cost will more likely to be going up because people prefer more relaxed, more modernized touch to their hotel rooms, to their services. Okay, so there are different, different service at, as in different approach that each and every hotel has. So for some, their focus is customer satisfaction. For some, their target is sophisticated personalized service. So the approaches can be different for different hotels, so which is why there can be a mishap, there can be a glitch in this. We'll now understand, take up cost-based pricing. The first one will be rule of thumb approach. So the rule of thumb approach sets the rate of any room at rupees 1 for each 1000 of construction of furnishing and cost of the room, assuming that the occupancy level would be 70%. The emphasis is placed on the hotel's construction cost, fails to consider that the effect of inflation of the rule of thumb approach to the pricing room also fails the consideration the contribution of other facilities, the services of the hotel, desired profitability. Many guests may pay for service such as food, beverage, telephone and laundry. If these services contribute to profitability, the hotel may have less pressure to charge for the higher rate of rooms.
we'll now shift our focus to Hubbard's formula. So this determines the average selling price of a single room. This approach considers operating costs, desired profits, and expected number of rooms sold. So in other words, this approach starts with desired profit, income taxes, and then add fixed charges and management fees, followed by operating overhead expenses and direct operating expenses. The Hubbard formula is considered a bottom-up approach to pricing rooms because it's an initial item, that's net profit, the net income that we receive, and that appears at the bottom of the income statement. To calculate the hotel's desired profit, we do it by multiplying the desired rate of interest, which is called ROI, right? By the owner's investment, the prior investment that the owner makes. We have to calculate pre-tax profits by dividing desired profits by 1 minus the hotel's tax rate, okay? Calculate the fixed charges and management fees. This calculation will include an estimating depreciation, interest expense, property taxes, insurance, building mortgage if there's any, land, rents that's there, and the management fees. We'll also have to keep in mind to estimate non-room operated department income or losses, that is the food and beverage department income losses, telephone department's income losses, and so on and so forth. Determining the room department revenue, the required room department's income plus room's direct department expense of payroll and related expenses such as direct operating expenses will have to be equal to the required rooms department revenue. And thus we can calculate the average room rate by dividing rooms department revenue by the expected number of rooms to be sold. So we'll end our discussion on Hubbard's formula.
With this we finish our first unit, which is establishing room rates. For your easier understanding, this chapter has been divided into 7 parts.